All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon. I'm sorry about my voice. I left it down at Autzen Stadium screaming at that Duck Beaver game last week. I normally just do Pac-12 videos, top 25 videos, Duck videos throughout the year. I talk Duck football. I talk Duck basketball. Anything you guys are interested in, we can obviously chat it up. But I always like to try to hit on some of these college coaching carousel news when they happen. And today's a huge one. USC, we know, have been looking for a coach the entire season. They were one of the first schools to fire their coach this year, Clay Helton. And they moved on to Lincoln Riley, a move that kind of surprised a lot of people nationally, based on the idea that Oklahoma is literally the dominant team in their conference. And why would a coach from Oklahoma go to USC, where USC hasn't been successful in quite some time? Now, there's a lot of things going on for USC. There's a lot of positive things for USC. But football's not one of them right now. Football is not a moneymaker for USC right now. They have empty stadium big time. They have major fan commitment issues. When they're good in LA, they're relevant and people show up. But other than that, there is not a consistent fan base that is passionate about going to those games. I've been there. I know. I've seen it firsthand. There's, of course, a passionate fan base for USC. Of course there is. They're a great fan base. USC is the most prestigious school in the Pac-12. But right now, currently, they have a lot of work to do. And it's not like a head coach is going to come in and change these issues. Some of these issues have been there for a while. Yes, they redid that stadium, and it is really nice, the new concourse. But it is a humongous stadium that is, most of the time, not even close to capacity. And it's in a technically an area of town that is kind of hard to get to for a lot of people in LA traffic during game days or whatever. There's a lot of things going against USC, I feel like, right now, comparatively to other schools in the conference. Again, USC for years had the money, the resources, everything. They had the beautiful facilities and this, that, and the other. Southern California, comparatively to every other place, when nobody had outdoor or indoor practice facilities, everybody was practicing outside throughout the whole fall. LA's got amazing things going on. This is why they were so dominant for years and years and years. They had the pick of litter. They had crazy amount of talent, and they fed off of it. And now they're in a situation where there's a lot of schools going to Southern California to pull talent. Oregon being one of them, obviously. Steve Sarkisian said that was one of his big push at Texas. But this Lincoln Riley move to me seems a little interesting in the timing of it, because of the fact of Oklahoma moving to the SEC, a move that I don't think is going to be that beneficial for them long term. I think it would be beneficial for them to stay in their conference and dominate their conference. But I get it. Paycheck's a paycheck. And I think Texas is going to have some real problems with it. But I just don't know if Oklahoma in the future is going to be the same Oklahoma football program that it is now with this different conference. It's just going to be interesting. So I don't think that this move is that big of a deal right now. Again, I'm really trying to make this the hugest deal, and it is. It's a big name from a big program coming to USC. But I don't know if he is an automatic fix. He's got a lot of issues here. Yes, they have talent. They got great talent. And I'm not trying to disrespect USC. I'm not. Don't make it sound like that. I'm trying to come at it from saying, realistically speaking, there's some major issues. The same thing with the guy who takes over at University of Washington. There's some major holes to fill there, and there's some work to be done there. So personally, as a Duck fan, I think it's great, because we need USC to be good. We need the Pac-12 to be respected nationally, and it starts with having USC good. If USC's good and Oregon can beat USC when USC's good, Oregon gets even more respect. This is how the game is played. And lately, in the last couple 5-10 years or whatever, the Pac-12 has been down and considerably compared to the past, to where it's hard to pick up those quality wins. And so Lincoln Riley coming out here maybe sees his path to the playoff being easier by winning the Pac-12. I do not see his path becoming easier. I think he had an easier path at Oklahoma running through the Big 12. And I know he had issues, but a guy is 55-10 as a head coach. Loses to Texas, loses to Clemson, loses to Oklahoma State this year, Alabama, Kansas State a couple times, Iowa State a couple times. I mean, the guy's literally had 10 losses and to some really, really good teams. So I tend to think that Oklahoma is the much better program. If you want to try to get yourself into the BCS, I think every single year you have that thing pretty much on a platter. It's just whether you can follow through with it or not. Versus USC, I think you have a very different situation out here. And just alone winning the South, I think, is going to be difficult for USC in the next 2 or 3 years. I don't think this is just like Lincoln Riley comes in with a offensive mind and changes the game. No, I do think he's a great offensive coach and he's done great things at Oklahoma, but he's had some seriously, seriously good talent to do that with. And he's going to have a tough time, I feel like, transitioning his offense to what they have right now at USC, a team that didn't really have an identity, a team that had been for years tailback you, one of the greatest running back histories we've ever seen in football, and then they go to the air raid. You know, I mean, it's like you can literally just get some of the best running backs, you always have some of the best offensive linemen, run the ball. And instead, they're throwing the ball all over the place, doing the air raid. So again, they just did not have an identity, and they're getting blown out in these games. They're not even competitive this year. The USC-UCLA game was an absolute embarrassment. I mean, those are the kind of things that, you know, not only will get your first coach fired, which it did, but it'll also make it incredibly difficult to make this thing rebound as fast as they want it to rebound. This is a program with very high expectations. And I think that they're going to be maybe a little slower than they wanted to be in the rebuild. I think it's going to take Lincoln Riley at least a couple, 3 years. And I don't know if Trojan fans are going to be all that happy if he comes out next year and wins 7 games and goes to, an Alamo Bowl or Holiday Bowl. Because I could easily see that. The South is tough. He's still got issues with ASU. He's still got issues with Utah. He's still got issues with UCLA. Right there, okay? And so that's just the South. That's not even talking about playing Oregon. And you know Oregon loves to play USC. That's not even talking about Oregon State, which beat USC this year, which I think has a chance to beat them in the future as well. Or Washington. Obviously, there's a storied program there. And when they get back to prominence again, they're going to be an issue for USC. So, again, I think this is kind of a lateral move for him personally, professionally. I think I get it. USC is a storied program, but so is Oklahoma. Are you kidding me? And the guy's from Texas, going to come out and live the L.A. lifestyle. I think he might see it as, hey, I'm going to make a bunch of money. I'm going to go live in L.A. I'm going to go be able to do whatever I want to do. I'm going to get out of the pressure cooker of CFP or bust, because you know that's how it is at Oklahoma. You think that's how fans are in Oregon. That's the whole dang thing at Oklahoma. And the pressure of the cooker there is real. And again, the guy's gone 12-2 3 years in a row. Then he goes 9-2 during COVID, and he goes 10-2 this year, loses Oklahoma State and doesn't go to the Big 12 championship game, and he's out. I mean, the guy is a dominant coach during his time there. But he's also had a dominant team. He's had one of the best teams. So it's going to be interesting to see how he compares to the years he had at Oklahoma. Give him 5 years at USC and see what he does. I don't think it's going to be anywhere near 55-10. I'll just put it that way. All right, guys. Hopefully everybody has a great holiday. And again, no offense to the Trojan fans. Again, I come in peace. I got a lot of respect for what they're doing down there and everything else, but I do think that this is one of these stories that they're going to love to talk about how great this coach is and how much control the coach is on the team and everything else. He's not wearing shoulder pads. He's not throwing the ball. He's not catching the ball. He's not blocking anybody. Yeah, they're calling plays, but a lot of people in college football catch up to people very quickly. Defensive coordinators are paid a lot of money these days to scheme against these offenses. Everything's on tape. It's not like you can go run away and hide. Ask Chip Kelly. The most innovative offenses always get caught up. And again, I'm not that scared about Lincoln Riley coming out to USC, because I think USC has a ways to go to get back on track to what they think is the top team in the Pac-12, because that's going to go through Eugene and Salt Lake City first. All right, guys. Thanks for watching Sports Chat 503. Have a great one. Adios.